Good evening and welcome to Wheaton College. My name is Chris Mitchell. I'm the director of Wheaton College's the Marion E. Wade Center, which houses a major research collection of writings by and about seven British authors, C.S. Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien, and Chesterton among them, individuals well known for their influence on contemporary literature and Christian thought. On behalf of the Wade Center and the gracious co-sponsors of this lecture, Tyndale House Publishers, I'm delighted to welcome you to this evening's lecture by Dr. Alistair McGrath, C.S. Lewis, Eccentric Genius, Reluctant Prophet. Now, in light of the fact that some of his research for C.S. Lewis Alive, the book on which this evening's lecture is based, was done at the Wade Center, the center awarded Dr. McGrath a Clyde S. Kilby Research Grant for this book and for his forthcoming book, The Intellectual World of C.S. Lewis, which is due out next month. Blackwell? Yes. Now, for those of you who don't know, the Wade Center is not only a research facility, we also have a museum which is open to the public that exhibits items belonging to the writers and rotating displays on their lives and work. And we invite you to visit the center, which is located across the street from Edmund Chapel. You will be able to find information about the center at our table in the lobby as you leave tonight. Now, we are very grateful to Dr. McGrath for his kind offer to give this evening's lecture. We also want to thank the team at Tyndale House that has coordinated and sponsored this event, in particular, John Ferreira, Maria Erickson, Cheryl Kerwin, Maggie Rowe, and Linda McKillop. And now it's my pleasure to welcome the president of Wheaton College, Dr. Phil Ryken, who will introduce Dr. McGrath and open the evening in prayer.
Like C.S. Lewis, Dr. Alistair McGrath was born in Belfast and discovered Christianity at Oxford University after a period of atheism. Today, he is one of the world's leading theologians. He serves as senior research fellow at Harris Manchester College at Oxford University, as the president of the Oxford Center for Christian Apologetics, and he is professor of theology, ministry, and education at King's College London. He is the author of many excellent books. These include the best-selling The Twilight of Atheism, The Rise and Fall of Disbelief in the Modern World, and more than 50 other books, including Bridge Building, which is an excellent book on apologetics. His Christian theology is internationally popular and I know will be familiar to many of our students. And he is the author of this book, which I picked up as soon as it came out, C.S. Lewis, A Life. My copy is autographed by the author, but you'll have a chance to get one of those if you wish by the end of the evening. It's published by Tyndale House Publishers, and we're pleased for our collaboration and partnership with them. Dr. Mitchell mentioned that Dr. McGrath was here on campus to do a little bit of his research on C.S. Lewis. I can also tell you that he read and annotated Lewis's complete works, reading them in chronological order, and also some 250 secondary texts on Lewis's life and context. He is a prodigious researcher. I first became introduced to Dr. McGrath's work through his two-volume Justitia Dei, which is a history of the doctrine of justification. And what a thrill it was, as I was a student in seminary, to know that at Oxford University there was this brilliant theologian deeply steeped in Christian theology and in the truths of the Reformation, and articulating those for a contemporary audience. I had the privilege when I was a student at Oxford to have a number of interactions with Dr. McGrath. I attended his lectures on Reformation at Wycliffe Hall, where he impressed all of us by bringing his lecture notes to the lectures and flipping the pages without ever actually looking at any of the pages. I've also seen him do this in seminars at All Souls College and other places. Those lectures were particularly helpful to me because as I had some opportunity to do lecturing during my time at Oxford, I drew heavily not only on his Reformation lectures, but also on his excellent book, Reformation Thought. And I will always be especially grateful to Dr. McGrath as the internal examiner for my doctoral thesis for actually deciding I had earned the degree. So that's Dr. McGrath will always have an especially warm place in my heart because of that. In just a few moments, I'll ask you to give him a warm Wheaton welcome, but will you please first join me for prayer? Our Father, tonight we want to give you praise for the special gift of the life and writings of C.S. Lewis, a sinner saved by grace, one of our brothers in the family of God. We give you praise for his conversion to faith in Jesus Christ, for his sanctified imagination, for his extraordinary gifts as a writer of a wide range of literature. And so many of us here tonight, Lord, can give you praise for the life and ministry of C.S. Lewis as one of your instruments of grace in our lives, for some perhaps helping to bring us to Christ, for many others deepening us in the life of discipleship. And Father, we also give you praise for the extraordinary gifts of Alistair McGrath, for his conversion to faith in Jesus Christ, for his literary gifts, for his range of intellect, for his ability to write both at the popular level and at the scholarly level and to touch many lives as a result. And Father, we pray that as a result of our time together this evening, that we would be encouraged in the Christian faith and return our praise and thanks to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. And will you please join me in welcoming Dr. McGrath?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, let me begin by saying what a huge pleasure it is to be here at Wheaton. The Wade Center were wonderful in making their resources available to me, and when I was talking to my publisher, we thought we must do an inaugural lecture somewhere. We thought Wheaton College is the place to give it. So I'm thrilled to be here and to be able to introduce this biography by asking a very obvious question. Why on earth have another biography of C.S. Lewis? There are many of them around, including one rather good one by a member of faculty here at Wheaton, Alan Jacobs. So why? Well, I think there are several reasons I'd like to mention. One of them is obvious, and that is that C.S. Lewis is profoundly interesting. I think that really is a starting point for any discussion. But of course, as many of you will know, there's been a massive rise in studies on Lewis in recent years. And so it seemed right to try and find a way of bringing all of this together to try and synthesize what we're finding in that literature. And I think also, as I worked in archives, especially in Oxford, I began to come across some material that seemed to me to really cast light on Lewis and perhaps illuminate issues which really we hadn't quite understood earlier. And I'll give you an example of that later on. And I think also to explain why Lewis came to fame, but I think more interestingly, 50 years after his death in 1963, he remains so influential. Indeed, many would say he is more influential today, 50 years after his death, than he was during his lifetime. So I think there's a lot of interesting points to touch base on. And also, I think sometimes biographers don't quite get Lewis's Irishness right, or perhaps occasionally get muddled about what goes on at Oxford. And as an Irishman and someone who lived at Oxford for many years, I thought I might be able to help things here a little bit. Why me to write a biography? There have been many good ones before me. Well, I have to admit that I became a Christian in 1971, not because of Lewis, but it didn't take me very long to discover that Lewis was someone who began to enrich my vision of faith, who actually reassured me about the credentials of faith, and has always played a major role in my own journey of faith. And that seemed to me to be something quite important. And likewise, I grew up in Ireland like Lewis, and I kind of have a feel for what was going on there. And that, I think, brings a little bit of clarity to some periods of his life. Likewise, as your president was saying, both of us went to Oxford University as undergraduates. We both ended up as Oxford Dons. And I think perhaps interestingly, both of us were outsiders. An Irishman coming to live in England is always on the periphery, at least to begin with. And I know what Lewis meant when he felt as an outsider at many points in his academic career. But most interestingly, of course, both of us started out as atheists. And both of us ended up as Christians while we were at Oxford. So I felt there were some points of contact there that were useful. And of course, my own background is in intellectual history, and that kind of way helped me illuminate some of the areas in which Lewis worked, which he quarried for his own presentation of the Christian faith. So let me tell you about the method I used in writing this biography. I think the main thing I did was to, in effect, line up everything that Lewis had published in chronological order of writing and work through it. And I have to say, this took rather a long time. That shouldn't surprise you. And it was immensely worthwhile, but I need to say also it was quite demanding. Because in effect, I thought this will help me understand how Lewis's style develops, understand how his intellectual ideas develop, and also, I think, give me some quotes I'd be able to use in the book itself. And I think that that was really quite worthwhile. Someone said to me the other day that they'd never seen so many quotes from Lewis that they hadn't come across before. And again, it's just because I saw these things and thought, that's going in. Then, of course, we reread the Second Religion on Lewis, which is very extensive, and did some work in archives. Oxford, Cambridge, London, and, of course, your excellent collections here at the Wade Centre. So why this biography? How does it relate to others that are already there? And I'm sure there are many here tonight who know Lewis and the literature about Lewis very well indeed. So perhaps I need to help you understand where to place this on a map. First of all, the book is friendly, but it's critical. In other words, I think Lewis is a great thing. But I'm also asking questions about how we know this happened. I'm trying to understand Lewis, not praise him, not criticize him, but just try and understand him and pass that understanding on to you. Unlike A.N. Wilson, I don't impose any Freudian sub-narrative on Lewis's development. And that, I think, is interesting because there are two books which I think stand in slightly different perspectives. The early biography of Roger Green and Walter Hooper, I think, were quite uncritical in some ways, whereas A.N. Wilson, of course, was rather critical. And I tried to move away from that by being appreciative of Lewis, but at the same time trying to point out things that need to be pointed out. And you might see similarities there with George Sayers' excellent biography of 1988. But in terms of approach, clearly, it is very different from George Sayers. Why? Well, Sayer knew Lewis. And that, I think, marks his biography out. He gives us a very good account of what Lewis was like as a person, as a living human being. And, of course, I didn't know Lewis personally at all. I only know Lewis indirectly through his writings. And that means that if you read my biography, you'll very often find yourself feeling that this is not really about Lewis the person, it's more Lewis the thinker. Although I think something of Lewis the person will come through. But I want to suggest to you that maybe my approach might be what Lewis would have wanted. Now, it may surprise you, but many of you will know what I'm talking about. In the great controversy of the 1930s, the so-called personal heresy, Lewis kept saying, look, what really matters about a writer is not the writer's history, it's the writer's books. The writer is not a spectacle, something you look at. The writer is a set of spectacles through whom you look at the world. And therefore, the important thing about a writer is not his or her history, but the works they actually produce. I'm not sure Lewis is absolutely right there, because I think understanding a writer's history and context really makes more sense of what they write. But I think Lewis is right to point out the fact that in the end, it's the texts themselves that really matter. After all, when Lewis wrote about Milton in his preface to Paradise Lost, in many ways he was saying, let's not worry about the history too much, let's look at the ideas, let's look at the texts, because that's what really matters. So how do we relate this biography to Alan Jacobs' book, The Narnian? Jacobs, of course, here on the faculty of Wheaton, moving, I know, to Baylor, but a very great asset, I think, for Wheaton. And I think there are some similarities. We have a similar attitude. We both think Lewis is a good thing, but we do have different concerns. My analysis is much more linear. I want to tell the story of Lewis's development. And so, in effect, I just lay things out chronologically to try and help us understand how Lewis develops, whereas Professor Jacobs is more concerned about the development of Lewis's imaginative life. And that's important, but I decided to tell a more historical narrative, trying to identify influences in his culture that may have shaped the way in which he thinks. And of course, for me, the whole apologetic side of things really is important. Whatever Lewis is as well as this, he is a very gifted apologist, and that's something we can learn from. So I tend to accentuate that aspect of Lewis's life. So obviously I need to explain what is new about this biography. If it simply is a reprisal of what's already been there before, then it doesn't really justify being there in the first place. So let's try and look at two main things that this biography does. First of all, it does present some new evidence about Lewis. In other words, things that we didn't really know or know about before, and tries to work out what this tells us about Lewis. And secondly, it offers new interpretations of evidence that people already knew about. In other words, it's not so much about discovering new facts. It's saying, look, we already knew about these things, but maybe there are other ways of making sense of them that might need to be put on the table. So let me give you examples of each. So let's go and ask, what sort of new evidence is there? I'm limiting myself to two items only because this is going to be a relatively short lecture. First of all, I came across a letter which Lewis wrote to the Swedish Academy recommending Tolkien for the 1961 Nobel Prize in Literature. That hadn't been seen before. Why is that interesting? Because as many of you will know, the relationship between Tolkien and Lewis, which was very, very close in the 20s and 30s, began to fall apart in the 40s, and by the late 50s, there was real alienation. Most scholars suspect, for good reason, it's more on Tolkien's side than on Lewis's side. This letter makes it absolutely clear that Lewis retained both admiration and affection for Tolkien even at that late stage in his life. Remember, Lewis died in 1963. This is late in his life. So that's a piece of new evidence, which I think just helps us shade in some detail in Lewis's life. But let me ask you another question. Many of you will know that Lewis served in the British Army during the First World War. He was wounded and had to be invalided out back home to England. He joined the Somerset Light Infantry. Most biographies say Lewis joined the Somerset Light Infantry and went to war. I wanted to linger and ask, why on earth did he join the Somerset Light Infantry? Somerset is a lovely county in England, and they make very good cider there, but Lewis had no historical connection with Somerset whatsoever. He, if anything, would have been expected to join a local Oxford regiment or one of the Irish regiments based in Belfast. Why should he join that infantry regiment? I'm putting on the screen now a document that you probably won't have seen before. We're going to dim the light so you can see it a little bit better. This is a photograph of a British Army document from, as you can see, Wednesday, June the 20th, 1917. And on the top line, you will see a record of recruit Lewis C.S. joining E Company on the 7th of May, 1917. That's Lewis joining up. You'll also notice on the far left-hand side the letters KOSB, the King's Own Scottish Borderers. That was the sponsoring regiment. The idea is that is the regiment Lewis would join unless he asked to join another regiment or he was identified as having skills that might make him transferable, for example, to the artillery or something like that. Here's something you may not know. This is from slightly later that same year. This shows a second C.S. Lewis. Look at the last line. This is a different C.S. Lewis who joined C Company on the 5th of July, 1917. And those of you who know Lewis's correspondence well will know there is a letter of July 1917 to his father saying, please, when you write to me, make sure you put E Company, because otherwise it might go to the other C.S. Lewis. And there is the other C.S. Lewis. Now, you all know that Lewis became friends with Paddy Moore. Paddy Moore was a man almost the same age as Lewis at Oxford at this time. They were at the same officer training group, and they shared a room together. They became extremely close, and of course, Paddy's mother, Mrs. Moore, comes into our story, and we may talk about that, or we might not talk about that, depending on how you feel about it, but certainly, Paddy Moore and Lewis became very, very close. We're going to dim the lights again, because I'm going to show you a document, again, you won't have seen this before, relating to Paddy Moore, giving him his full title, and here it is. This, look at the third name on the list. That's Paddy Moore by his full name. What I want you to notice is the sponsoring regiment behind Paddy Moore, the Somerset Light Infantry. It's very clear to me that Lewis asked if he could join the Somerset Light Infantry because that is where his best friend, Paddy Moore, was going to go. So those are documents I think that just cast light on things that otherwise we might not have understood. Let's take the lights up again and we'll move on. What about new interpretations? Here what we're doing is looking at things that people already knew all about, but saying perhaps there are other ways of looking at. And as some of you, I think, will know, there is one field of Lewis's life which I look at very, very closely, which seems to me to need re-examination. And this is the date of Lewis's conversion. In other words, the date when Lewis began to believe in God again after his period of atheism. And Lewis himself, in Surprised by Joy, gives a very moving account of this development, which he links specifically with Trinity Term 1929. In other words, between the 8 weeks of the 28th of April and the 22nd of June 1929. And no one had any reason to challenge that date. But as I mentioned, I read Lewis's writings in chronological order. And it seemed to me that as I read it, I saw no significant change in Lewis's tone or voice in 1929, the year of his alleged conversion. But if you read his letters and so on from 1930, there's a change in tone sometime in the middle of the year. I can't date it precisely, but if you read it continuously, you see the change. And so I began to look at this very, very closely. First of all, let's remember that Lewis's father died in September 1929. That's between 3 and 5 months after Lewis's conversion. There's no reference to God in Lewis's reflections on his father's illness or death. You might think that if you believed in God, that might somehow feed into your thoughts on that matter. And again, there's no change in tone. By that, I mean the sort of way in which Lewis expresses himself. That doesn't change in 1929, but it does about midway through 1930. The point I'm making is there's really no evidence for a change in Lewis before the middle of 1930. And perhaps most interestingly of all, Lewis was actually hopeless about dates. He stopped keeping a diary by 1929, and he was not good at remembering dates. In fact, Lewis, as you probably know, became vice president of Magdalen College in 1941. The chief responsibility of that job was booking rooms for college meetings. And I have to tell you, either those rooms were not booked at all, or they were double booked, because Lewis was simply not good at handling dates. Might he have got this date wrong? Then, and very importantly, I think, there's a letter of February 1930, written to one of his closest friends, Owen Barfield, telling him, look, something awful is happening. It's as if what I would call the ideal is becoming real, behaving like God. Look at the language. The spirit or real eye is showing an alarming tendency to become much more personal. It's taking the offensive. It's behaving just like God. You better come on Monday to the latest, or I might have entered a monastery. Now, that's extreme language, I think. But the point I want to make is that echoes Lewis's language and surprise by joy about God advancing on him like a cat advancing on a mouse. It's obvious his conversion lies ahead of him. And Owen Barfield later in life would say, this letter to him, written in February 1930, marks the beginning of Lewis's process of conversion. So again, there is something there we need to think about. And then finally, as many of you will know, Lewis tells us that he started doing two things as a result of his conversion to belief in God. He was not yet a Christian, but nevertheless, he wanted to mark his change in attitude by a change in behavior. So he started going to church, in this case, Holy Trinity Heading Quarry, and to Magdalen College Chapel. Remember, he was a don at Magdalen College. And we can date this transition. Because in October 1930, Lewis wrote to his best friend, Arthur Greaves, explaining that his routine has changed now. He now goes to bed earlier because he started going to morning chapel at Magdalen College. What I want you to remember is that during Oxford's long vacation, July, August, September, no chapel services would have been held. Lewis, in effect, began going to chapel as soon as he could once the new academic year resumed. So it seems to me that there's a lot of reason for thinking Lewis's conversion must have happened between February and October, most likely, I think, in late May, early June, but I can't prove that. So this is very much a question for discussion. I'm not saying I'm right, I'm just saying this is something that perhaps we might need to think about. But I think many of you here tonight will say, well, you know, that's doubtless very interesting, but isn't that of purely academic interest? The important thing, surely, is that Lewis got converted, not that Lewis got converted on this particular day at this particular time. And actually, I think you're right, because all of Lewis's writings that we celebrate and value date from far after this date. I'm just saying that as a historian, I think we need to revise this episode, but I'm not sure how important it is in terms of understanding Lewis or appreciating what comes forth from him. So what I want to do is emphasize that this biography tries to tell a story. In other words, I'm concerned, in effect, to take you through what's happening. And that means I don't do detailed theoretical analysis. There's a lot of research behind this biography, but I see no need to slow the narrative down by going into great detail about some of the issues we talk about. And so later this year, sometime next month, the month after, we're publishing another volume which is much more academic. The results of this are built into the biography, but the heavy academic lifting is done in another work called The Intellectual World of C.S. Lewis, which has 8 substantial pieces of academic research, including these 4 essays, reflecting on the rather strange literary character of Surprise by Joy, looking at what Lewis calls his new look in the 1920s, looking at Lewis's astonishing use of visual metaphors, light, sight, focusing, and of course his very famous argument from desire. So there is more to come, but tonight we're talking about the biography. And one of the major themes we see in Lewis is this idea of a big picture. It's very characteristic of Lewis, and this, I think, is one of his finest statements of this basic idea. It's from the end of his very famous essay, Is Theology Poetry? And it goes like this. I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen. Not only do I see it, but by it I see everything else. A very visual image, but what he's saying is not simply there is evidence for Christianity, but that Christianity is able to make sense of what we observe as a sun rising on a landscape enables you to see things more clearly. Sure, there are shadowlands that remain, but you nevertheless see things more clearly than would otherwise be the case. And this is very, very central to thinking about Lewis. It helps us understand his conversion. He suddenly was able to make sense of things which otherwise seemed disconnected. Stories that were different were seen as being part of a same greater narrative. It also makes sense of his argument from desire. What Lewis is saying is, look, if the Christian big picture is right, then what you would expect is for us to long for something that no earthly object can satisfy, because that is a pointer to its true goal in God himself. What Lewis is saying is this big picture that Christianity offers helps us make sense of what we observe and what we experience, including, for example, his argument from morality. Namely, we have this deep sense that there is a moral authority outside us, which we acknowledge in all our dealings with others. So let's talk about Narnia. Why should I talk about Narnia? Well, I guess the simple answer is because you think that would be a good thing to do. And in fact, this biography really, if it has a target audience, it's for people who have read Narnia or seen the Narnia movies and are saying, we'd like to know more about this man. Who is he? Where do these ideas come from? How do they fit into a bigger scheme of things? What else did he write? And it seems to me that Narnia is a wonderful way into understanding Lewis. And so this biography is organized around three worlds that Lewis occupied. Two of them are real physical places in England. The third is an imagined world, which we know, of course, as Narnia. And what I do in this book is say that because Narnia is so central, I, in effect, demarcate this by having a separate section on Narnia. Why? Because, as many of you will know, Narnia was written over a period of several years. Some would say over a period of 10 years. It's open for discussion, but you can see the point. If you have a biography that does a year-by-year account of what Lewis thought and did, then Narnia is smeared out over a long period of time, which means it gets diluted. You can't see the underlying unity of Lewis's reflections on Narnia. So what I do is to tell the story of Lewis arriving at Oxford and eventually becoming very unhappy there, and then we pause and we tell the story of how Lewis created Narnia and why it is so significant. Then we move on to Lewis's move to Cambridge, and in effect it allows us to linger over Narnia and appreciate why that is so important and why Lewis needs to be taken so seriously. So obviously I want to explore with you a question, which is how did Lewis come to write Narnia and what can we learn from it? I think we can track this back to Lewis's experience on the eve of the Second World War, where in effect Lewis began to think in terms of writing a children's story. Now I emphasize this happened in August 1939 because of a very famous debate between Lewis and, and Elizabeth Anscombe, seen here later in life, at the Socratic Club in February 1948. And many of you will know about this incident. It plays a major role in A.N. Wilson's biography of Lewis. And basically, Anscombe argued that Lewis's critique of naturalism in his book Miracles wasn't really up to the job. Now, I want to argue with you that Anscombe A thought Lewis was right in what he said, but basically he had not developed his argument well enough. She was not an agent of contradiction of Lewis, but rather an agent of refinement. You can do better than this. Let me see if I can encourage you to set this argument out in a better way. Now, A.N. Wilson argues that this caused Lewis to retreat from rational argument into fantasy. I'd like to suggest that there is indeed a degree of fantasy here, but it might relate to A.N. Wilson's argument rather than to Narnia. And the point I want to make is that Wilson says, look, Lewis wrote Narnia because he ceased to believe in the power of reason to promote belief in God, or Narnia is a return to a childish world because Lewis was stung into retreat into childhood by his public humiliation by Elizabeth Anscombe. But I need to say to you, it's just not like that. That really, Wilson's argument that Lewis turned to fantasy because he gave up on reason is simply untenable. The evidence just isn't there. For Lewis, and this is one of the most characteristic features of his thinking, reason and imagination come together. Imagination does not contradict reason, but rather takes us beyond it. And Lewis saw these as enriching each other. And so I think there's a very important point to make there. Lewis is no rationalist, if you mean by that someone who limits reality to what reason can show. He, in effect, builds on that and then goes further than that. But perhaps a more important point is this, that Lewis was already using fiction, fantasy, imagination as a means of apologetics and critique of positions he believed to be wrong in his so-called Ransom or Space Trilogy, which were all written before his encounter with Anscombe. There's no way he moves into fantasy as a response to Anscombe. He's already doing it. What Anscombe does is enable him to refine his argument against naturalism, but not begin writing fantasy. So what is Narnia all about? I want to try and explore with you why Narnia has such great appeal. I don't think we can understand this without appreciating the importance of stories in helping us to understand this world and our own place within it. And in many ways, I think the Chronicles of Narnia resonate very strongly with our basic human intuition that our own story is part of something bigger. And once we grasp what this bigger story or bigger picture actually is, then that enables us to see our situation in a new light and to behave in a different way. So it seems to me that Lewis is really saying you need to grasp the big story to make sense of your own story. And certainly, like J.R.R. Tolkien, Lewis was deeply aware of the power of stories to captivate the imagination and make us receptive to ideas because we'd embraced the imaginative element of the story that we were being told. So that, I think, is very important. Lewis is echoing a thought we find in G.K. Chesterton. Every true artist, Chesterton writes, feels that he is touching transcendental truths, that his images are shadows of things seen through the veil. That's a great quote from Chesterton. We know that Lewis liked it, and it's a very important way of understanding what Lewis is doing. He is telling stories that engage us, that excite us, that embrace our imaginations as a way of saying, look, there is a bigger story. Our stories are part of that. And once we understand what this bigger story is, things make more sense, and we're enabled to live our lives in a way that leads to us behaving virtuously. Now, I think Lewis is emphasizing a number of points here, but what I want to stress is that Lewis is saying there are multiple stories that are told about ourselves and about the world, and we are forced to choose which of those stories, to use more complex language, which of those meta-narratives are right. And you can see immediately how this resonates with the lion, the witch, and the wardrobe. And as I think you all know, at an early stage in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, the four children begin to hear stories about the true origins and destiny of Narnia. They're puzzled. They have to make decisions about what persons and what stories they are going to trust. Is Narnia really the realm of the White Witch? Or is she a usurper whose power will be broken when two sons of Adam and daughters of Eve sit on the four thrones at Caer Paravel? Is Narnia really the realm of the mysterious Aslan, whose return is expected at any time? And as you read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, you see the children wrestling. Which of these is to be trusted? The story tells us everything, but which is the right story? And as you all know, gradually one narrative emerges as supremely plausible, the story of Aslan. And each individual story of Narnia turns out to be part of this greater story of Aslan himself. And The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe gradually lifts the veil on this bigger picture, which is amplified in later stories in the Chronicles of Narnia. And the point that I want to emphasize is that the grand story, the big story, makes sense of each of the individual stories of Narnia. They all seem to be part of a bigger picture, and you're left feeling there is sense that can be made of things. There is a story that can be trusted. There is a world shaped by these stories which we are meant to inhabit and which shapes the kind of people that we are. Realizing that Aslan's story is the real story enables the children to understand their experiences with a new clarity and depth, just like a camera lens bringing a landscape into sharp focus. But as you all know, Lewis did not invent the grand narrative which is reflected in Narnia. What he does is to take the Christian grand narrative of creation, fall, redemption, and final consummation and rework this within the pages of the Chronicles of Narnia. As many of you will know, Lewis had a conversation with J.R.R. Tolkien in September 1931 on the whole issue of the truth of what he calls myth, using the technical term to mean a story that is lodged in the deeper realities of things and which also is able to captivate our imaginations. And Lewis realized that Christianity was not simply about ideas, but about a big picture, a big story, which made sense of every other story. And what Lewis is trying to get the readers of Narnia to understand is that the Christian story makes sense. It is usable in generating virtue, and it also positions rival stories, like, for example, the rise of secularism. And Lewis really is suggesting that we are drawn to Christianity, perhaps not so much by saying this idea is right, that idea is right, but rather here is a big picture which is so imaginatively compelling, we want to step into it and be part of it. For Lewis, you don't begin by looking at each little snapshot and then paste them all together to get the panorama. You see the panorama and you are overwhelmed by it and taken into it. And then you start looking at its individual components in more detail. Now, it seems to me Lewis has done something remarkable in the Chronicles of Narnia. I think actually one of the things that Lewis does very, very effectively is to help us feel what it's like to believe in God, how it affects the way we behave, our emotions, our fears, our anxieties, our hopes. And Lewis, I think, does this extremely well indeed. And I want to emphasize, I think, that Narnia is much richer, much deeper than you might expect. It doesn't help to say Narnia is just a children's story. Narnia is a children's story, but it is far more than that. And certainly talking to many people in writing this biography, I met many parents who had had Narnia read to them and were now reading Narnia to their children and finding themselves caught up in it and moved by it as they read it to their children. So Narnia, I think, really matters. Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury, who is now Master of Magdalen College, Cambridge, Lewis's old college, wrote a little book on Narnia last year in which he simply makes the point that Lewis speaks to him powerfully, credibly, at a deep level about things that others simply fail to do. And one of the points I want to make very clearly tonight, and it is made very clearly in the biography, is that there is a lot more to Lewis that we have yet to discover. He's deeper than we think. But of course, many of you will say, well, you know, this is true, but surely you are being unduly positive about Lewis. And I think I want to emphasize that in this biography, I try to pay Lewis the greatest possible compliment, which is to be absolutely honest about him. I see no point in portraying Lewis as a saint or as a figure of ridicule. He is a flawed human being like all of us, but a flawed human being through whom and in whom God was able to do some very great things. I want to suggest to you that what I've tried to do in this biography is tell things as they actually are. And certainly the pre-conversion Lewis was a very difficult and strange person. And my feeling, which I cannot prove, but there are hints there in the correspondence, is that when Lewis became a Christian, he set himself the agenda of engaging with his old self and beginning to overcome its limitations. So what sort of weaknesses might we point to? Well, I think there are perhaps several areas we could mention. I'm going to mention one, which I think you will all expect me to mention, and that is Lewis's attitude towards women. Lewis was behind his time, I think, and very much behind our times. I make that point simply as an observation. It's not a criticism, it's simply an observation. And I think many of you would say, well, look, what did you expect? This was a man whose mother died when he was not even 10. He was sent away to all boys boarding schools. He went into the British Army. He then went into all male colleges and stayed there for the rest of his life. What hope was there for him to be able to understand women? But nevertheless, we do need, I think, simply to make the point that many feel that Lewis treats women, I think, in ways that were probably acceptable in British culture in the 1940s, but are not so nowadays. Now, of course, we see this to some extent even in Narnia. Most leading roles are taken by male agents, but not all. And again, you could make a very good point in response. If there is a central character in the Narnia narratives apart from Aslan, it is Lucy. And that, I think, does need to be said. Lewis is complex. You can't really reduce him to simple stereotypes like somebody who was way behind the times. So let's make sure we tell the full story. because in his attitudes towards eugenics, Lewis was ahead of his time. You may wonder what I'm talking about, because this debate has subsided. But in the 1920s and early 1930s, the leading representatives of the avant-garde, the liberal elite in England, like Bertrand Russell, H.G. Wells, advocated the forcible sterilization of the mentally infirm. Why? Because they were social Darwinists. Letting these people breed damages the gene pool. Let's ensure the survival of the human race by limiting those who are allowed to have children. Now, we have forgotten about this episode. And one of the reasons we've forgotten about it is that one of its leading critics was C.S. Lewis, who simply said, "This is inhuman." And I think, in that sense, he was ahead of his time. And even more so, on vivisection, where he was way ahead of his time. One of the reasons that Lewis became an unpopular figure at Oxford was his vigorous critique of vivisection. Everyone else thought it was fine. Lewis did not. Lewis argued very famously that being human placed responsibilities upon you, including treating animals well and with dignity. That is part of the obligation that we have towards God, because the created order has been placed under our stewardship. We need to treat animals with great respect. And of course, this brings us back to Narnia. Narnia is often ridiculed for portraying animals as thinking and sentient and virtuous characters. Childish, the critics say. But when you read Lewis on vivisection, and remember, he was writing on vivisection in the 1940s, you begin to realize that Lewis is realizing that the way you think about things affects the way you behave towards them. And Lewis is inviting us to see animals in a new way. And that ought to affect the way in which we behave towards them. Now, clearly, there is much more I could say about Narnia and about Lewis. But I want to end, if I may, just by making a few points. First of all, I very much hope you will enjoy reading this biography. But this is not really what I had in mind. What I really want you to do is feel this biography makes me want to read Lewis. In many ways, what I'm trying to do is to give you a gateway or a portal to something that will make you say, this Lewis guy sounds interesting. Let's read him. And I hope I've given you a framework which will help you make more sense of what you read and appreciate it all the more. But the second point I want to make is this. As biographers work on their subjects, they very often find their attitudes towards them changing. I have a colleague who was working on a biography, and she gave it up because she came to detest the person she was writing about. I found out a lot more about Lewis as a result of writing this and researching this. I want to make it absolutely clear to you that my admiration for Lewis has increased. Sure, he was complex, but the more you look at him, the more you find material to admire. For example, the way he coped with his brother's alcoholism and Mrs. Moore's dementia in the late 1940s. And I came away from this feeling that Lewis perhaps needed to be respected and admired more than we think of him. But the final point I want to make is this. In the final chapter of the book, I ask the question I flagged up right at the beginning of this lecture. Why is Lewis still being read today? And above all, why is Lewis being read by evangelicals? Because after all, in the early 1960s, evangelicals would have seen Lewis as pipe-smoking, alcohol-drinking, you know, just the sort of person they would want to run a mile from. Why this radical change of thought? When after all, my biography confirms he smoked a pipe and he drank alcohol. What I think is happening is this. I think evangelicals have realized that Lewis reaffirms the credibility of the Christian faith, and that Lewis does not in any way dilute a rigorously biblical faith, but rather enables them to take it further, enriching it, deepening it, without in any way taking anything away. And I've spoken to many younger evangelicals who've said, look, this enables me to go deeper into my faith than might otherwise have been the case. They see Lewis as a friend who enriches their vision of faith. And I think that's part of the story of the rediscovery of Lewis. What will things be like 50 years from now? We just don't know. But my prayer would be that somehow someone else might arise who would be a C.S. Lewis for the next generation. But I'm so thankful that we have C.S. Lewis for this generation, because he is a reminder of the grace of God. This is my final point. Lewis, remember, began as an aggressive atheist. He ended up as one of the most passionate and convincing exponents of Christianity we have known in recent years. What brought about that radical transition? Well, Lewis is quite clear. It was God who met him and God who transformed him. In the end, this is partly a biography of C.S. Lewis, but it's also a testimony to the ability of God to take people, to turn them around, and to do great things through them. And you know, I think that speaks to all of us. Lewis's life is the story of someone whose life is transformed by the grace of God and reminds us that that can be true of us as well. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Alistair. We do have some time for questions, and there are two microphones here in the aisles. So please feel free, get up, direct your question to Alistair. And we have some time.
Thank you for the lecture, Dr. McGrath. A question for you. Which is something that's always interested me, even outside of Christian circles, it seems as though C.S. Lewis is greatly respected, even though his Christianity obviously comes through. I'm curious as to why you think even non-Christians respect him and what we can learn from that.
I think there are some non-Christians who treat Lewis with contempt. You might think of Philip Pullman, who says Lewis sent one of the girls in Narnia to hell for being interested in lipstick and men. And I mean, you know, let's just be straight. Lewis didn't say that. So let's get that out of the way. Most, I think, people who are not Christians would find Lewis very interesting. He is someone who can tell a story that captivates. And you know, that is something very, very important, because when I read someone like Dan Brown's Da Vinci Code, I mean, I read the story and I find a page-turner, you know, but I don't like the ideas he's built into his narrative. And I think that people realize that really one of the best ways of communicating ideas and values is through telling a story which embodies them. And they see Lewis as doing that very well. Even a critic of Christianity who is asked to nominate a credible representative of the Christian position will very often say, look, Lewis is the one you want to read. I think also Lewis is still remembered with great affection and respect at Oxford. And obviously I sort of made my way around Oxford High Tables in researching this biography, asking people what they thought of him. And those who taught English literature would say something like this: we still put him on our reading lists, because there are few who've been able to absorb the internal structure of things like Paradise Lost or the Faerie Queen like Lewis. Things have moved on, but it's a great starting point, and I think that's very important. Lewis, I think, reminds us that to be a Christian is not to hang your brains up. It, in effect, is about bringing the full resources God has given us to our study of God's word, of God, and whatever else we think is important in God's service. So thank you for that.
Thank you for the lecture, Professor McGrath. I'm a great lover of Lewis, and one of the things that's always perplexed me about him is, as you read his works, you see somebody who, as you say, is very concerned with the great meta-narrative, and yet at the same time, I've always been struck at how little C.S. Lewis refers to and interacts with Scripture. He's somebody, I mean, you have reflections on the Psalms, you have some exceptions to this, but in my reading of it, it seems like he doesn't really talk that much about Scripture. Instead, he's more working from creational reflections and from reason and his great interaction with literature. And I'm just wondering, do you agree with that assessment that Scripture is sort of on the periphery for him? And if so, why is this? Why, for somebody who's so concerned about the great story and us fitting into it, why doesn't he talk more about that great story as it's revealed to us in Scripture?
I think that's a very good question, and I know exactly what you mean. Lewis doesn't really talk very much about the Bible at all, and you mentioned his reflections on the Psalms. And actually, when you read that, it's mostly things like this. This is quite difficult to read. How do we make sense of this? Because there's some very problematic passages. I think the answer I can give is this. You're quite right. Lewis does not engage directly with Scripture. I think that's very clear. But there are passages in which he talks about how he does approach Scripture. And what he says is, look, the right interpretation of Scripture is the way in which Christian writers down the ages have understood Scripture. Now, I see that as a pattern in what Lewis is doing. Because what he is doing is he's reading people like John Donne, George Herbert, who, of course, do engage with Scripture actually quite surprisingly well. Think of Donne's sermons, or indeed Herbert's sermons. But they transpose Scripture into poetry or into metaphorical language. And Lewis is picking up on Scripture at one stage removed. In other words, he's not engaging with it directly. He's engaging with other people's engagement with Scripture. And what he's saying is, look, I take from these what Scripture is all about, and I see them bearing witness to this great story. So Lewis actually, for an evangelical, is not using the right language and is not speaking in the right way at all. And I think that one of the things I notice is many evangelicals say, well, we recognize that, but we read the Bible and we think about this a lot, and we can kind of pick up on Lewis once we've done that. In other words, they see Lewis not as establishing a practice of reading Scripture, but rather as helping them to do things with what they've discovered from reading Scripture, which helps them to make even more sense of it. So I think that's part of the picture. Lewis is ambivalent. You know, he doesn't really engage with Scripture directly, but he's clearly deeply shaped by a biblically based orthodoxy. So it's not direct, it's indirect. But it means that those of us who value the direct engagement of Scripture can still find him a very valuable dialogue partner in enriching our vision of what the Christian faith is all about. So I think that's a very good question. Thank you. Please.
Thank you for your lecture. I enjoyed it very much. I wonder if you had any thoughts or reflections on Warren Lewis and the relationship between the brothers. When I was in college, I read Warren Lewis's The Splendid Century about Louis XIV's France, and I was very impressed by it and other things I've read by him. It seems to me he's more than just C.S. Lewis's shadow, and whatever you might, reflections you might have on him.
Yeah, I like that. I think someone needs to write a biography of Warney, but I think I need to say the material I'm not really sure is there. But certainly, he is, I think, very much in Lewis's shadow. I think there are several things we could say here. One is that it's absolutely clear that Warney was a central figure in Lewis's childhood. He was the older brother. He was a symbol of strength and stability. And of course, they created their own individual worlds. They read books together. They played in the attic at Little Lee. It was a very important relationship. And it's interesting to note how Lewis himself took the initiative in reconnecting with Warney and getting him to move to Oxford after he demobilized in 1931 or whenever it was. Lewis clearly saw that as being recreating the family he'd lost through the death of his mother. So I think Warney was a very important figure. Also, as you rightly say, Warney was actually a scholar in his own right. He spoke French. He served in France during the First World War. And the books he wrote on French history of the 18th century in particular, I think, remain very well written. Certainly, Tolkien had great regard for some of Warney's writings. I think the problem was that Warney had a weakness, which I think probably emerged during his army period, and that was alcohol addiction. And he never actually managed to break that habit. And I think that was a real problem for Lewis, who began to realize in the late 1940s that A, he had a very sick elderly person, Mrs. Moore, on his hands, and also his brother, who he'd hoped would help him to look after her, was kind of a permanently immobilized by drinking too much whiskey. And, you know, that was very, very difficult for him. And certainly, if you read Lewis's correspondence from the last few weeks of his life, you know, in effect, it's to the effect, my brother has abandoned me. There's a very strong sense of loneliness. Obviously, Warney came back eventually, but as you will know, Warney didn't attend his brother's funeral. He'd been drinking on the day and just couldn't get out of bed. So I think Warney is a complex character, but you're absolutely right. There are points at which you begin to think there is something there about Warney that perhaps we need to look at more closely. And I hope sometime in the future somebody will really look at him in more detail. We need to know more about his army record, because certainly Maureen Moore suspected that Warren Lewis left the British Army not because he retired, in inverted commas, but because he was kicked out because of a drink problem. So I think it would be good to know more about that. But you're absolutely right. There is more to Warney than meets the eye. Thank you. Please.
In The Horse and His Boy, Lewis gives a very stereotypical view of Muslims, or perhaps, you know, the turbans and the swords. And I think Aslan in the same book, you know, says that there are many people outside Narnia who would come to know me. So I wonder if, do we see any racism in Lewis, or stereotypical, perhaps, you know, English, you know, perception of the Ottoman Empire, especially with the Great War, and also what his perception would be of Islam in general, considering Aslan's comment there.
Thank you. Lewis is shaped by his own culture, and the Calamines are widely interpreted as a sort of satirical representation of the Ottomans. Now, of course, Lewis would know that from the First World War, but of course, you probably know that in his research into Edmund Spenser, some of the books that he would have read were by scholars who were also experts on Turkish colonial history. So, in effect, Lewis probably had a cultural stereotype of his age in mind when he wrote that. Now, the issue which I'm not sure we can answer is whether Lewis is simply saying this cultural stereotype is right, or whether he's in effect sending the cultural stereotype up by in effect mocking it. You know, in effect creating a stereotype that is so implausible that it begins to subvert the stereotype itself. So there is an open question here as to whether Lewis is simply uncritically replicating a prejudice or actually subverting it by portraying it in a certain way. I don't think we know the answer. What we do know is that Lewis did remain in contact with a number of prominent Muslim scholars and actually kept writing to them and treated them with great respect and sympathy. I'm trying to recall the particular one I have in mind. Unfortunately, I need to check his correspondence to get the name right. But certainly there was one very prominent British Islamist who converted to Islam, who Lewis constantly treated with great respect. So I think the answer is there is clearly something that needs to be looked at there, but I don't think it takes quite the form that you find, for example, in Philip Pullman's portrayal of it. Thank you. Please.
You mentioned that one of your goals for this book was to read Lewis critically, like take an unbiased, pretty objective look at him. I was kind of curious, you mentioned Pullman a couple of times and other critics of Lewis's, not his faith necessarily, but his writing and the way he chose to tell his stories. And I was curious, as you undertook your objective reading of his work, if you found that some of his critics had a point, or if you discovered some drawbacks or weaknesses that you hadn't noticed previously?
I think every attempt to offer an objective critical analysis invariably has certain subjective assumptions that you just can't get away from. So I think it's important just to begin by making that point. Certainly, one thing I noticed was that some of the criticisms of Lewis are just a bit over the top. I think that needs to be said. But nevertheless, there are some anxieties that I think it's right to say may have something behind them. And that means I think that we need to read Lewis with those concerns in mind. To give you an example, I mean, I would want to say that Lewis's attitude towards women is understandable, but nevertheless, it is something that does kind of appear, and you can't really get away from it. For example, in Mere Christianity, Lewis does occasionally make some remarks about women which you feel are both baffling and completely unnecessary. I think really what I'm saying is that we do need to, in effect, say, to admire Lewis is not to say, yes, 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 but in effect is to say there is so much that's good here, but there are points which we need to say, well, that might have been okay at the time, but not now, or even in one or two cases, that wasn't even okay at the time. And I don't think that's about being disrespectful to Lewis. I think it really is just saying, look, you don't need to agree with Lewis at every point in order to get something from reading him. And what I find is that there are points at which I say, Lewis, you're right, that's so well put and such a good point. There are points where I say, I think he might be wrong. There are also points where I think, actually, I don't think he's right, but it may be that I'm wrong, and Lewis is really challenging me to rethink. So when I talk about critical, I just mean, in effect, not going in and saying he's always right or he's always wrong, but rather saying perhaps we just need to look closely at everything, because there is much that's good there that we can take away and use, even though there are points where I think we might want to say, look, this is something that might have been fine back in 1943, but we have moved on, and if we were saying that today, we would say it in a very different way. And that's why I've been hinting, particularly towards the end of this lecture, that what we really need is a new C.S. Lewis who's able to, in effect, be sensitive to where we are now, because we have moved on a long way from the 1940s, for example, but be able to say the essence of what Lewis would have said, but in a culturally sensitive way. That means that cultural sensitivities don't blind us to what Lewis is saying. Thank you.
I see C.S. Lewis is really writing in a modernist context. What would a postmodern C.S. Lewis look like? Do you have you ever thought of that? Maybe somebody like Peter Kraft?
I think as I read Lewis, I agree with you. There are many parts of his writings which are modernist in the sense that they play very, very well with the agenda of the Enlightenment in mind. And certainly parts of Mere Christianity read like that. But there are other parts where Lewis almost seems to straddle the modern, postmodern divide, his appeal to stories, his emphasis on the role of the imagination. And what I think I see Lewis offering is a robust and holistic vision of Christianity which can't be reduced to either something modern or something postmodern. And indeed, I was talking to somebody about a week ago, and here's someone who began as a very modern person when he was younger, has become much more postmodern in his older days. And he was saying to me, Lewis has been with me throughout my journey. That in effect, you know, when I was younger, I liked these writings. Now I like these writings and still C.S. Lewis. And I'm wondering if that actually helps us to understand the appeal of C.S. Lewis. Because as you know, he's loved by a remarkable variety of people. But I sometimes think that this remarkable variety of people probably like different bits of C.S. Lewis. And I think it's interesting to note how there are some who feel themselves drawn to his rational analysis, which is very, very good, and others who are more drawn to his imaginative embrace of Christianity, encouraging them to think more in those terms. I think Lewis is complicated. And I think genuinely, it's not as if he's saying, now I'm modern, now I'm postmodern. I think he doesn't think like that at all. It's much more he has this vision of Christianity, which is neither modern nor postmodern. It's just classic. and that in effect what he enables people to do is to realize that in a modern context there's some things that can be said, in a postmodern context there's some things that can be said as well. And I think that Lewis is really saying this isn't me, this actually is what Christianity is like. And we don't need to be frightened by modernism or postmodernism because there are resources there that we can actually take and use. Thank you.
First of all, thank you for your lecture. I really appreciated it. As you mentioned earlier that you divided a section of your book specifically dealing with Narnia, a question that popped into my mind was whether or not Michael Ward's work, Planet Narnia, and his research helped you, inspired you in any way, and in what way that might have been?
I think Michael Ward is a very good Lewis scholar, and his book, Planet Narnia, I think has identified something that the rest of us have overlooked. I think that just reminds us that, you know, we got to keep reading Lewis, because I think there may be things that Lewis hoped we would find that we haven't always found just yet. And certainly, I think there is something in what Michael Ward has to say. And certainly, I found it to be valuable, and in a short section of my discussion of Narnia, I talk about Michael Ward's approach and why I think it takes us in some interesting directions. So I do think there is something in what he's saying. I think I want to be careful, you know, it remains to be proved that Lewis intended us to find that, and it may be that he's overstated at one or two points. But what I will say is, he's offered a way of explaining the distinct identity of each of the Narnian novels, which otherwise is very difficult to account for. Each of the books has its own distinct tone or feel. And what Michael Ward has done, I think, is say, look, maybe Lewis has an organizing framework which actually governs each of those distinct characters. So I'm very sympathetic to what he's saying, but I'm not absolutely convinced just yet. But I'm still thinking. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your lecture. I was really curious when you talked about, again, the way you structured the biography with kind of locationally specific. And I was wondering if you found that Lewis's writings significantly differed between the Oxford period and the Cambridge period, and how that worked. And also, as far as choosing a locational structure for the biography, if you considered, I guess, different ways of approaching it, whether you could structure a biography based on Lewis's relationships or whether life events or something like that.
Thank you. I think that's a very perceptive question. I did try a number of possible arrangements, and this was the one I felt in the end best suited the audience I was trying to reach. So the identity of the audience played a significant role in helping me clarify a structure, but there could have been others. I think I do notice a difference between the Oxford Cambridge and the Lewis Cambridge. Let me tell you what I see. You'll probably remember that when Lewis gave his inaugural lecture at Cambridge, the leading theme was Renaissance. And of course, Lewis is talking about primarily, you know, the whole way of schematizing the history of literature and saying that what we call the Renaissance might actually not be quite as straightforward as we think. But when you look at it more closely, you begin to wonder, is Lewis sending out a signal about his own Renaissance? And I certainly notice a change in his modality of writing once he goes to Cambridge. And let me tell you what I see. Number one, the most obvious thing is that he tends not to write works of apologetics as such. There are unquestionably apologetic elements to what he writes. But Lewis seems to be writing more, not so much for the outsider, as for the insider to help them grow in their faith. You think of, for example, Reflections on the Psalms, the Four Loves. Those are not apologetic works. Those are works enabling Christians to think things through. And I think that ties in with remarks Lewis makes at least 3 points in the 1940s, that being an apologist is spiritually wearying and exhausting. And I wonder if he just felt, maybe my time has come, it's time to hand over to somebody else, but I still want to keep writing about faith its importance. And so he begins to write about how we nourish and sustain the faith that we use in doing apologetics. In other words, apologetics is exhausting for our faith. Let me offer you some resources to keep you going in faith while you still do apologetics. The other thing I notice is that when he's away from his Oxford context, it's as if the controversies, the anxieties he had then are left behind him. And this is a very subjective perception, which, you know, is completely open to challenge. I just sense there's a sort of relaxed character to the Cambridge works that I don't always see in the Oxford works. And if that is so, it's simply because he's moved to a different location. He is at some distance from the tensions he's now left behind. He had a reasonably easy time at Cambridge, as I'm sure you know. I just feel that actually his changed situation is reflected in his writings. So I think the move to Cambridge was more than just geographical. I think actually we see a slightly different Lewis in that period. Thank you.
I'm not sure how many are here tonight who remember Wheaton prior to C.S. Lewis becoming its patron saint. But I happened to be here at that time in the late 40s and very early 50s. And Lewis was looked upon as the label that was given by Dr. Kenneth Conser, a liberal evangelical. And I often thought that that was an interesting blending of two traditions, and I think in a sense, part of this was hearkened by the comment on Lewis's view of scripture. And I do know that that was the very strong position of Kenneth Conser. I do want to pursue a theological reference and framework that has been used by some, and I've really not encountered much in this. And perhaps in your study, you came across Lewis's concept of Bultmann and what Bultmann was advocating, especially in the late 40s and early 50s?
The answer is, yes, I have. But I don't talk about it in this book because I felt that it would really significantly slow the pace of the narrative and actually almost envisage a change in the audience I had in mind, because most people who love Narnia are kind of going to be a bit baffled by reading Bultmann. However, I can reassure you on this point. In the other book I'm publishing shortly called The Intellectual World of C.S. Lewis, there's a major chapter on Lewis on myth. And in that, I deal specifically with Lewis on Bultmann. And I will tell you what Lewis says. Lewis says, in effect, that it's not as if we can say that there is this mythical outer crust, and then inside it there's a really important bit of Christianity. And all we need to do is take away the myth, and we're left with what really matters. Lewis is saying that this story is an integral part of what Christianity is. You cannot, to use Bultmann's phrase, demythologize it. Christianity is primarily a narrative about God's actions in history, and you just can't get rid of that narrative without getting rid of Christianity at the same time. And Lewis, in effect, says that Bultmann seems to be a literary amateur who's no sense of the importance of narrative in conveying and sustaining worldviews. And he also makes the point, which I think is entirely fair, which is that Bultmann seems to use the word myth simply to mean something old-fashioned that's out of date. And of course, for Lewis, the word myth means this grand vision, this story, rooted in reality, embracing the imagination. And what he's saying is that if Christianity didn't have that, then actually we wouldn't be paying all that much attention to it. So he's very critical of Bultmann, but primarily, I think, on literary grounds, feeling that Bultmann hasn't really understood what this is all about. Now, there's a lot more that needs to be said, but happily, if you're interested, you'll be able to read that chapter, and all the details are there. And it's a very dull chapter, too.
This will be the last question.
Thank you for your lecture. And I actually had more of a controversial question regarding like how C.S. Lewis viewed salvation. And some people think, or he may have been an inclusivist, and meaning that he thinks salvation is necessary and it is necessary to be received through Jesus, but there are other ways to receive salvation. If so, do you think that contradicts with Scripture in regards to salvation? And I just wanted to hear your opinion on this.
Well, Lewis's view on salvation is quite complex, both in terms of what salvation is and also how salvation comes about. And he's quite emphatic that the whole basis of salvation is Christ. Very, very clear, that's how salvation happens. But in, for example, The Last Battle, you know, there are passages which seem to suggest that Lewis is adopting an approach to salvation which does not require salvation to take place on the basis of an explicit response to a savior. He seems to think there may be some more implicit things. So in effect, when you see the savior, you just recognize this without actually having properly thought about it. Now, obviously, the difficulty is trying to find the right label to apply to Lewis. And certainly, you know, most people would say, well, that we can think of three labels. There's either exclusivist, inclusivist, pluralist, and Lewis clearly is not one, he's not three, so he has to be some sort of inclusivist. And I know exactly what you mean. The real difficulty is that Lewis doesn't fit onto that map terribly well. You know, it's one of these things we draw a map and we think we've placed everybody, and Lewis is just a bit difficult to place on that map. Let me try and say, I know exactly what you mean. In the 40s, Lewis takes a very strong view on what you need to do to be saved. But in the 50s, you just sense that it's weakening a little bit. I think he gets this from G.K. Chesterton, who you probably know says, we must very much hope that all men will be saved, but must nevertheless act as if they are not. And I think that Lewis is trying to express in Narnia in particular the hope that all be saved, while at the same time, in effect, exploring the idea that nevertheless something needs to be done. But I think he doesn't entirely resolve the questions. So you're right to ask it, and I think the answer is he leaves this tantalizingly open-ended. Thank you.
Thank you once again, Alistair. And thank you as well to Tyndale House Publishers. And I want to thank our staff and volunteers of the Wade Center and the other departments of Wheaton College that have helped make this event possible. Now, I'll just note this for you. If you'd like to hear this talk again or direct it to others, it will be available on the Wade Center's website for the next few months. You can also come to the Wade Center and listen to it. Our open hours are Monday through Friday, 9 to 4, and most Saturdays we're open 9 to 12. Now, you also may be interested to know that Dr. McGrath is speaking in chapel on Friday, and you can listen to that online through the Wheaton College website. Now, I'd like to invite you to the auditorium lobby for some refreshments. This, too, we give thanks to the generosity of Tyndale House Publishers. There you're going to have an opportunity to purchase Alistair's book if you haven't already and to have it signed. Also on your way out, if you haven't received the 7 brochure, there's a discount copy there, a coupon there that you could use if you want to pick up a copy of 7, which you can purchase at our table, the Wade Center table, along with some other books and items. So once more, I just want to thank you for coming. And again, thank you, Alistair. Thank you. Good night.